Good morning. Thank you for joining us here on this, the fifth Sunday of Easter. It's so good to have you here with us, joining us as we worship online, as we raise our voices to our Lord digitally. However we're able to praise God, that is a blessing. And I am so happy that you're here with us today, sharing in that blessing. So today we're going to take a look at, what is probably one of the most interesting missionary stories in the Bible. We're jumping over to Acts chapter 17, and we're going to look at Paul's time in Athens, where he goes there and he preaches on Mars Hill. And this is one of those missionary stories that's perplexed a lot of people over the years, but it has some real key advice for us in terms of how do you preach, how do you share the gospel with maybe someone who isn't even interested in listening. How do you share the gospel when it's not easy? So we're going to take a look at that and get some pointers from Paul and maybe take some encouragement from his experiences, his hits, his misses, his successes, and try to figure out how best that we can imitate Paul in sharing the gospel. So blessings on your service. And let us begin as we lift up our voices to the Lord in praise. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all of your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The scripture for this morning is taken from Acts chapter 17, verses 16 through 31. While Paul was waiting for them at Athens, his spirit was provoked within him as he saw that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and the devout persons, and in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. Some of the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers also conversed with him, and some said, "What does this babbler wish to say?" Others said, "He seems to be a preacher of foreign divinities," because he was preaching Jesus and the resurrection. And they took hold of him and brought him to the Areopagus, saying, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? For you bring some strange things to our ears. We wish to know, therefore, what these things mean." Now all the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there would spend their time in nothing except telling or hearing something new. So Paul, standing in the midst of the Areopagus, said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious. For as I passed along and observed the objects of your worship, I found also an altar with this inscription, 'To the unknown God.' What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you: the God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man, nor is he served by human hands, as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mankind life and breath and everything. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling place, that they should seek God in the hope that they might feel their way toward him and find him. Yet he is actually not far from each one of us, for in him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your own poets have said, for we are indeed his offspring. Being then God's offspring, we ought not to think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of man. The times of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Oh,
Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. So today we get to look at this story about St. Paul. That's really, it's always been one of my favorites. I absolutely love what Paul does here and the way that he works and how we get to see that. But it's given people headaches over the course of history. Dedicated pastors, missionaries, evangelists have often looked at this text and said, really? This is our example for the Apostle Paul? It seems like it's one of those things that we would say, don't do this. Whatever you do in sharing the gospel, don't do it this way. But Paul does this. So we got to look at it and say, why? And the answer, I mean, not to give away the ending, right, before we get into the story, is that Paul, he takes advantage of an opportunity. He's presented an opportunity, and he takes it. And maybe there's a lot to learn there. It reminds me of a joke that I once heard about a guy in a small town who was the local town barber. And he'd charge, you know, a reasonable $10 for a haircut. And did great business for years and years and years until one day this new haircutting place moved into town. And they were the inexpensive haircut option, right? The supercuts. They charge $5 for a haircut, which was not great for this $10 a haircut barber. And he was real worried about his business. You know, weeks turned into months, and he slowly saw that his business, it went down and down and down, and he was very concerned about it. So he started talking to the customers who did still come, the ones who stayed with him, and he figured out why. And it turns out all he had to do was go up to the front of his store, put a big sign in the front window that says, "We fix $5 haircuts." You know, that's taking advantage of an opportunity, right? Seeing, instead of seeing this as a challenge, a threat to his business, he's going to come right in there and say, "We have the solution to your $5 haircut." And maybe that resounds with you, particularly right now, being that we're in the coronavirus haircut time period, right? As you can see, my long hair got trimmed down this past week. I think those local barbers are going to do a pretty good business once all the restrictions are lifted and they can kind of put up the signs in their windows that say, "We fix coronavirus haircuts." But looking at Paul's situation, he takes that opportunity not to give haircuts, but to spread the gospel message of Jesus Christ. And we got to fully understand this. We got to know where Paul's coming from and what his history has been up until now. And if we take a look at our text and the text just before it, we can get a good glimpse into why he does what he does. So let's start. You know, our text starts in chapter 17, verse 16 today, but let's go back a little bit and start more when he's in Thessalonica. So beginning of chapter 17, Paul goes to Thessalonica and he's on his second missionary journey, right? And he's going around town to town preaching Jesus Christ. And he's there in Thessalonica, and he does the same thing that he always does. He preaches in the synagogue for weeks, every Sabbath day, and telling them about Jesus. But the people in Thessalonica, they don't really respond well, you know, as a whole. There's some people that start to believe and follow Paul, but for the most part, the Jews in Thessalonica, they don't want to hear about Jesus and this new Christianity flavor of Judaism. So they run him out of town. Paul basically has to flee for his life from Thessalonica. And he goes to a town called Berea. And Berea, things are going pretty good there. People are more receptive. They listen more towards what Paul says. And, you know, some of them start to believe in Jesus. But then that crowd, that mob from Thessalonica, catches up with him. They followed him. They chased him all the way to Berea. And once the Thessalonica mob shows up, Paul has to flee from Berea as well. So Paul, you know, kind of middle of the night, flees from Berea. He gets on a boat and they take him to Athens, which is where our story picks up today. So you got to kind of understand that Paul is on the run. right? He's had to flee two towns, the last two towns he was in. He's had to flee for his life because of this message of Jesus Christ that he's preaching. And that's got to be a little bit disheartening, right? You want to share the love of Christ and have everybody respond and you know, maybe not thank you, but at least be happy that you've shared that message. But that's not been Paul's experience. Little wins here and there, but for the most part, it's been a tough battle. And that's how it was preaching the gospel of Jesus in the very beginning, right? Paul is a trailblazer among Gentiles and among the Jewish people, preaching this new message of Jesus. It's a very tough life, right? So Paul, he gets to Athens, and he's taking a look around, basically. And he's never been to Athens before, but he sees in Athens something that really, it motivates him. It almost, our text today, it says it provokes his spirit, I think is the words. Let's take a look at that verse. That's going to be chapter 17, starting with verse 16. Now, while Paul was waiting for them at Athens, his spirit was provoked within him, and he saw that the city was full of idols. And that Greek word there, provoked, it isn't just kind of motivated. It's angrily motivated, right? It's kind of poking somebody until they finally get provoked enough to turn in anger and try to stop, right? This is how Paul's spirit responds to walking through Athens and seeing idol after idol after idol after idol. And this is not surprising because this is Athens, right? This is Athens, Greece. And this town had been under Roman rule for about 200 years now, but they never lost their history, their deeply rooted history in Greek mythology, right? They have their worship of all the Greek gods, plus all the Roman gods, right? So this is a very deity full city. And we can see that even now today. I mean, if you go to visit Athens, you see still the big temple to Athena, right? We know that as the Parthenon. If you've ever seen the Parthenon or pictures of that, that's the remnants of the temple of Athena. And, there's another big temple, a temple to Zeus, which we still see some remnants of it as well. And these are huge. Think of those big, the Greek pillars, the beautiful, beautiful design. But this is a temple. And it's an active temple at this point, right? It's not just archaeology and architecture. It is where people went to worship and sacrifice and all the things that are associated with worship of gods. And in Athens, they had the whole Greek pantheon. There was an idol for every Greek god, plus many, many more. There was a Greek historian called Pausanias who wrote about this at that time. And he said that Athens had more idols than all of Greece combined. And all the rest of Greece combined. That's how many idols they had there and how it was really, truly a center for, what Paul and what we call idol worship. So as Paul is walking around seeing all this for the first time, it really hits him hard. Because there he is trying to preach this message of Jesus Christ that he has had revealed to him to be the one true way. And with everything that he's went through the past couple towns, now to come here and to see so many false religions and so many people worshiping false gods, it stirs his heart. Even though he's had these difficult times in the past couple towns, he is ready to get back out there and to preach the message of Jesus. So he does. He starts telling people about Jesus. And this goes over, good and bad, right? Because, here's the thing. In Athens at this time, we believe that while they had all these different idols that they worshipped, you know, they were certainly no stranger to having many, many different gods. It was only permitted to worship the authorized gods, right? So you could worship the old Greek gods, you could worship the Roman gods, but you know, they had enough gods. Don't bring in any more gods. So if you came in with, like Paul was, preaching a new deity, well, that was sort of on the no-no list, right? You just didn't do it. So they kind of come back at Paul and they say, well, tell us a little bit more about this. What are you teaching? Is this just Judaism, like we know and you know, we have an established Jewish community? Are you still really just teaching Judaism? Or is this, you know, one of those things that kind of encroaches on the you know, thou shalt not territory, where they don't want any new gods? So they invite Paul to go and speak at the Areopagus, which is, you know, just translates as Mars Hill, right? It's Mars Hill. So this is, you know, another hill kind of devoted to the god Mars. And this was a place where the ruling councils would gather, and, you know, there was a lot of debate that would go on here, right? It was a public area because Athens, they loved debate. You know, this was sort of, it was the heart of Greek thought and culture, which is really going strong at this time. So Greek philosophy, Greek thought, it was, you know, many ways centered here in Athens, if not just embodied by Athens, at least. And they loved to stand around and debate issues, to talk philosophy and religion. And this is why Paul gets his sort of, you know, moment in the sun, why he's allowed to speak there at the Areopagus. First off, because they want to kind of vet what he's saying to see if it's legal, right? Or, and they also want to, you know, just hear him out, because that's the kind of people they are. And Paul is mostly talking to these two groups, right? There's that's mentioned in our text. There's the Epicureans, and then there's the Stoics. And this was two big schools of thought at the time. So the Epicureans, they were the ones that they loved life, right? If you wanted to have fun in life, the Epicurean life was for you, right? They were the guys that said, let us eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die, sort of thing. They wanted to get every last bit of enjoyment out of life that they could. And the Epicureans, they weren't quite atheists, but maybe you call them practical atheists, something like that. They believed that the gods existed, but that they were just sort of spirits out there, and they had no influence on the physical world here. So they didn't really matter to us. They were just sort of off there kind of things. Which is, you know, it's great if you want to live a life where there's no consequences for anything you do. There's no punishing God. There's no pleasing God. It's all just about, you know, having a good life, having a good time. And that was the Epicurean model. And they were one of the groups that was there talking with Paul. And the other group that's mentioned is the Stoics. So the Stoics were almost, in many ways, it feels like the opposite of the Epicureans. They were a very serious bunch. They were all about self-righteousness. They believed in a sort of pantheism. They had a large group of gods that they believed in. And they did not believe in a resurrection. So this life was what there was. There was nothing more. There was no afterlife, resurrection or not, or even just, you know, an afterlife sort of thing. Nothing like that existed. For the Stoics, once you died, that was it. You're dead, you're dead. And these two groups, the Epicureans and the Stoics, they hear Paul speak. And because of their love of debate and ideology and thought, they invite him to come speak more. So they all go up to the Areopagus, and they give Paul a chance to tell them exactly what this is, this new teaching that he's bringing them. And this is where Paul makes that missionary turn that so many people have questioned over the years, whether or not, you know, it's right to spread the gospel in this way, or if Paul crossed a line. All right, so let's take a look and see what you think. So Paul, he's standing there on Mars Hill, and he says to all the people who are gathered there, he says, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious." Right? So he's complimenting them in a way. He's trying to open them up a little bit to the message. "For as I passed along, I observed the objects of your worship. I found also an altar with this inscription: to the unknown God. What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you." So stop and recognize what Paul's doing here. Think about that for a moment. He knows that he's kind of treading a little bit on thin water if he's bringing in a new God, right? If he's trying to suggest to them a different God than what's one of the approved gods. So he uses that opportunity that he saw as he was walking, as he was looking at these idols, and he finds one that says, "to an unknown God." So these people of Athens, they had you know, invested so much in getting an idol for every god that they were afraid that maybe they'd missed one. Or maybe there was a god who hadn't revealed himself to the people yet. So they created an idol for this theoretical god that they didn't know if he did or did not exist. And Paul takes that as an opportunity to say, wait, you don't know if he exists or not, but I'd like to tell you about him. And it's a great little in that Paul can use. And at the same time, he's kind of covering himself with this whole, you know, authorized God thing or not, because literally he's just taking one of the idols they already have, so you can't arrest him for that. But at the same time, it opens the door for Paul to teach about Jesus. I mean, that's a win-win. So even if Paul makes this, you know, this kind of strange move where he seems to be connecting an idol to Jesus, and normally, you know, at the seminary, they would probably teach it not to do that. Paul, he shows his creativity and witness here, and he shows, you know, what he's doing is he's taking advantage of an opportunity that God has given him to spread the message to people that he might not be able to spread the message to otherwise. So is it the greatest way to share the gospel of Jesus Christ, to bring this idol into it? No, probably not. And I wouldn't recommend that we do that in sharing the gospel with our neighbors, right? But maybe what we should do is open up the possibility of you know, doing whatever we have to share the message of Jesus. You know, maybe that's what we should be taking away from this, that the ultimate end of spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ is the most important thing. You know, it's difficult, right? And I think it's given theologians, you know, lots to talk about over the last 2,000 years. It'll give us a lot to talk about over the next 2,000 years, too. But let's see how it works out for Paul. So he says that, and then he continues on with verse 24. "The God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man. Nor is he served by human hands, as though he needed anything, since he himself gives all to mankind, life and breath and everything. And he made for one man every nation of mankind to live, and all on all the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling place, that they should seek God, and perhaps feel their way toward him and find him." And I love that part. I love what Paul says there, that perhaps we should feel our way towards God and find him. Because isn't that the Christian journey that we take? Isn't that what we do here in church the path that we walk our whole lives, to feel out God and try to find him. It's like Paul has put that in just the perfect descriptive words for us. And I think there are different ways for us to follow that, to try to feel out God and to find him. But what we're talking about, the path that we're journeying down, is the road to Jesus Christ. That's what Paul's talking about. That's what we do here in the church. We want everyone to find their way to Jesus, to find the path that leads to him, to find that feeling of God. Because there is no more important message that we can share with the world than the gospel of Jesus Christ. Right? Think of all the things that you could possibly tell somebody. What is more important than salvation and eternal life? You're talking about forever, eternity. That is literally, just by definition, the most important thing. It's far more important than the Epicurean ideas of, you know, let us live it up and be happy for in this moment, carpe diem, you know, but forget about the future. That's not the gospel of Jesus. Right? The gospel of Jesus is that we come to him and we find happiness and peace forever. Which, you know, it pushes away the Epicurean ideas, it pushes away the Stoic ideas who didn't even believe in an afterlife to begin with. You know, this is something, it truly is something new that Paul is preaching to them. And thankfully, there are some that respond to Paul's message that day. Not a lot, not all of them, unfortunately. But Paul does pick up a few very faithful believers. And maybe there's a message in there for us too, a lesson that we can learn. When we think of the greatest witnessers in all of history, you know, the most effective missionaries, Paul's got to be on that list. Can't deny that. But look at Paul's track record at these last three towns. You know, he's chased out of one, he's chased out of the other, and he sort of fails for the most part at the third. And yes, he has some wins. He picks up a little bit here and there, a few people. But for the most part, overwhelmingly, he's not converting, you know, 99% of the people. Paul's happy to take those few percent. And if that's what Paul can do, and he's St. Paul, why are we getting discouraged? Because we tell somebody about Jesus and we don't have that 99% conversion rate. We're not going to have that. That's not how it's going to work, right? There are people that are always going to deny the gifts of the gospel that God gives us. But we should strive for just imitating Paul, doing the best we can, and letting God worry about the numbers. You know, he's going to bring who he wants to bring. And there's going to be people that are always going to reject that. But that doesn't stop our responsibility of just sharing the good news, of taking that leap, going out on the edge, standing there on Mars Hill like Paul and saying, Jesus died for you. And that through faith in Christ, we can have eternal life. We have an opportunity in this world to share the gospel of Jesus just as much as Paul did standing there in Athens. And it's probably even easier for us than it was for him. So we have no excuse, right? We have that same responsibility to go out and spread the gospel just as all the apostles did, just as Paul did. Right? We have that same directive from our Lord to go out and to share his name. All those who believe in Jesus have a responsibility to tell others about Jesus. You know, we use that term responsibility And it sounds almost kind of heavy, like you have to do this. This is your responsibility, right? But it's so much different than that when we're talking about faith. We're talking about giving people gifts, the greatest gift, right? We should be talking about this in terms of, you know, not your responsibility to share the gospel, but your privilege to give people cake and ice cream sort of thing. Like, that sounds good, right? We'd love to do that. But the gospel is so much better than that. People in this world have questions. People in this world, they struggle. They are out there trying to feel their way through life, but they're grasping at thin air because they don't know what they're looking for. We have the ability, the knowledge, to point them in the right direction, to show them what it is that they've felt that they're missing this whole time. We can show them how to feel their way, not to emptiness and despair, but to feel their way to God. To feel their way to a relationship with Jesus Christ, their Savior, their Lord, who loves them so much that He died for them, that He shed His own blood, forgiving their sins, and then offers them salvation and life eternal. That's the greatest blessing, both to us as givers of that message and to them as hearers of the message. So don't be discouraged in this world, in this life, as you carry out your duties, your responsibilities as Christians. Don't be discouraged when you don't see it working instantly with everybody around you. Know that the Holy Spirit is there working even behind the scenes and stuff that you can't see. You might not even know how effective your witness was. But simply just do like Paul. Take the opportunity and every chance you get, every town that you're in, every town you run out of, take the opportunity to tell people about Jesus. Tell them what He means to you. Tell them what He means to them, to everybody. Share the good news of the gospel. And then pray that the Lord will come in, that He will send the Holy Spirit to pull them the rest of the way, to lead them, to guide them, to feel Him out and have a relationship with Him. Amen. And know that the peace of Christ, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us now confess together our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Oh,
us pray to our risen Savior on behalf of the church, the world, and all people according to their needs. Thank you, Jesus, for your faithful servants who have openly proclaimed what otherwise would have been hidden to us, that you are true God and true man, crucified and raised from the dead for the forgiveness of sin until eternal life. Thank you for sending the Holy Spirit to teach, comfort, and guide us in your way forever. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give a double portion of your Spirit to missionaries of the gospel. Use them to bring many to faith in you. Guide and direct all who teach the faith to the next generation of believers. Bless all they do that glorifies your name. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Give the members of this congregation the observant eye and quick wit of St. Paul, who proclaimed your gospel to skeptical Greek philosophers. Though we may not always speak with Paul's eloquence, help us to relate to people around us with words and stories that resonate with them. Help us to share the hope that is in us and the love you bear for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. The nations do not know you, dear Lord, and they suffer because they are starving for your word of life, truth, forgiveness, and salvation. Unleash your Holy Spirit throughout the world so that our leaders seek to obey your Father's will, and all those who blindly serve an unknown God may instead feel their way to finding you, their Redeemer and Lord. Teach all of us to seek peace, do justice, love mercy, and walk humbly in your sight. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Deal gently with all who are afflicted by pain, confusion, sorrow, remorse, or despair. Heal every hurt they have sustained. Bring them into a place of refreshment, health, and hope. Give compassion, wisdom, and patience to everyone who cares for them, and sustain them with your gracious Spirit. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We praise and magnify you, dear Jesus. Accept our prayers and lay them at the feet of your Father, who with you and the Holy Spirit reigns gloriously as our Lord and our God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen.